Jesus says in John chapter 14, truly, truly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also, even greater works than this he will do. Jesus clearly says, he who believes in me will do these works, even greater works. And Jesus doesn't lie. And Ellen White says that the work is going to close with greater power than it started. In fact, I'm looking to some paragraphs right now. For instance, in Desire of Ages, page 667, the Savior promise to his disciple is a promise to the church at the end of time. Who is the church at the end of time? Let me, in fact, share the screen so you can see the paragraphs for yourself. I hope you can see it right now.
Yes, okay. We can see it.
Wonderful. It says here, the Savior promised to his disciples is the promise for the church at the end of time. God did not design that his people would achieve small results. All who will go to work, trusting in him, not in themselves, will certainly realize the fulfillment of his promise, greater works you will do. Basically, I want to say, this paragraph is very plain, very clear. It says that those who trust in him will do greater works. Now, I want to read the next paragraph. The gospel still possesses the same power. Why don't we witness the same results? Through the Holy Spirit, the disciples are supposed to receive marvelous power. Now, listen carefully. The disciples were to have the same power that Jesus had. The gospel was supposed to be presented not as a lifeless theory, but as a living force. God desired that his receivers of grace should be witnesses to its power. Now, I want to ask you before we start, where is that power? Do you see 5,000 baptized every day, Monday 5,000, Tuesday 5,000, Wednesday 3,000, Thursday 8,000, every day, every week, every month? We don't see that. Do you see the dead resurrected? Do you see the sick healed? Do you see extreme power, revival? Where is that power? We expect the latter rain. We know that when the early rain came, the Holy Spirit was poured over the praying disciples, and they spoke in tongues, and miracles happened, and the church spread in 32 years over the known world. We know that happened. We know that at the latter rain, when you finish the work, very soon, we will see the same power. Ellen White says that people with illuminated faces would go from place to place. Miracles will accompany the work. Thousands will be baptized. Where is that power? We love Jesus. We work hard. I hope so. We see some results, but we certainly don't see revival. Many times people go to church and go back home and they are not filled with power. They are not transformed. We talk to our families, we talk to our neighbors, and we don't see results. What is the problem? I want to touch a little on what I think is the problem. Paul says, I've been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. I'm dead. I no longer live. Let me ask you, how many of us are dead? When I was a kid, I was about 7 years old. I went to school. It was during communism. And the kids started to make fun. You are an Adventist. You are an Adventist. You are an Adventist. And they were ha, 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 laughing, making fun. I started to cry. I went home. Dad, they said that I am an Adventist, the whole class. And my father said, why are you crying? Aren't you an Adventist? I said, well, I am. Then why are you crying? Oh, they hurt me. My father took me to the cemetery. And my father showed me a grave. And then my father said to me, I want you to call this dead guy Adventist. I said, but he's dead. Call him an Adventist. I said, hey, man, you are an Adventist. And my father said to me, what did he say? I said, well, he is dead. And my father said, oh, call him stupid. I said, I cannot. You taught me not to speak bad. Call him stupid. I looked to the grave. I said, hey, man, you are stupid. And my father said, what did he say? I said, nothing. He is dead. Dead people don't know. My father said, I want you to hit him. I said, no. Hit him. Okay, with my feet, I hit him. I hit the grave. And my father said, did he say, ouch? No. Did he say anything? No. Why? I said, he is dead. And then my father looked to me and said, son, people will keep hurting you as long as you are alive. When you are dead and Christ lives, then people cannot hurt you anymore. You know why we are hurt? You know why we have problems? Because we are alive. Dead people have no problems. Only living people have problems and cannot be living. Either Jesus is living or you are living. If you are living, Jesus is dead. We have a form of religion denying its power. If Jesus is alive, then we are dead. Jesus says, listen carefully, unless a grain would fall in the ground and die, the grain will be alone and will produce no fruits. But if the grain will die, he will produce much fruit. Paul says, I die daily. This is the greatest challenge. Ellen White says that self needs to be crucified. I want you to understand. It's a lot easier to know doctrines. It's a lot easier to eat healthy. It's a lot easier to keep Sabbath. It's a lot easier to go to church. It's a lot more difficult to die to self. I apologize, I can still hear an echo and that distracts me a little, but I will try to ignore it. Paul says, I have been crucified and I no longer live. God is calling all of us. God is calling us to be crucified. Unless we die to self, we will never produce fruit. The reason we don't produce fruit is because we are alive. Let me explain something else. Jesus says in Luke chapter 14, if anyone comes to me and doesn't hate mother and father and brother and sister and car and house and bank account and job and his health and his life cannot be my disciple. Unless you give up everything, unless we surrender everything, we cannot be disciples. I want to give another explanation. You see, all people in the Bible, Moses, Abraham, Joseph, Daniel, you name it, Peter, Paul, all of them have surrendered everything. Moses gave up everything. Abraham gave up everything. Joseph lost everything. Daniel lost everything. Paul the apostle gave up everything. Peter gave up everything. For you to be used by God, to do everything, you have to give up everything. To the degree that you surrender, to that degree, God can use you. If you surrender much, God can use you much. If you surrender little, God can use you little. And it seems to me that people who love Jesus a lot, they surrender a lot. And whatever we don't surrender, that's what we worship. Whatever we don't surrender, that's what chokes our relationship with God. I'm going to give you a story as we start. I was in the army. I was a lieutenant. I was in some type of special forces that was called Genius. And in that group in the army, we are trained to shoot any type of weapons. We are trained to go in any type of battle. We are trained to go where the army could not go. One soldier could go alone and plant a bomb and destroy a bridge or a mountain or a house. We could put a bomb in a pencil or in a telephone. We could go where the army could not go. One person could go and do some more people, something that more people could not do. And in this situation, during communism, when I was in the army, the secret police, the like KGB in Russia, in Romania was called security. The guy that was responsible with the Communist Party overseeing the garrison, he came to me and he said, "You are the enemy of the state." I said, no. I love my country. I am praying for my country. He said, "You don't work on Saturdays. You need to choose either God or country." I said, "Well, God comes first, but I love my country." He says, "You need to work on Saturday." I said, "I cannot. I work every day. I work night. I cannot work on Saturday." He said, "What if there was an emergency? What if there was war and somebody shot me? What would you do? Let me die?" I said, "No. If somebody shot you, I would save your life. What if it was on Sabbath? I would save your life. What if," I said, "listen, man, if your life is in danger, I would save your life. If your house was on fire, I would put up the fire. That's an emergency, but there is no emergency now. And therefore I don't work on Sabbath. I don't need to save anybody's life." He said, "Now you need to put me first above your God. I am your God. We are in a communist country. There is no God. You need to choose who comes first." And he said to me, "If God comes first, we will put you in prison." And he proposed 14 years prison in the most difficult facility in the country. Many people who went to that prison never came back home. What would you do if you were me? Would you go to prison or give up Sabbath? It's easy to say I would go to prison, but sometimes we have hard time to even give up smaller things, not only freedom or life, but to give up some money or some time or some pride. Sometimes we have hard time when we go through small crisis, not a big crisis. And we think we love Jesus, but crises show who you really love. What you don't surrender shows who you really worship. And so, saying that, somebody sent me a message to lower my microphone. I'm going to try to do that. I'm not sure how to do it, but I will try to do it. Anyway, and so it was not easy to choose between 14 years prison in a communist country in the toughest facility or Sabbath. It was not easy. You may think it's easy until you get there. And so, I prayed. I went to the warehouse and I prayed, "Lord, please, please, please save my freedom." The captain called me and he ordered me to dig a hole. It was Saturday morning and he said, "I want you to dig a hole." I said, "I cannot work on Sabbath." And he said, "It's a command. I want you to dig a hole in the ground." I said, "It's Sabbath. I cannot do it." "I want you to imagine it's an emergency. The enemy airplanes are throwing bombs, attacking you, and you need to dig a hole to hide." I said, "Well, it's no war, it's peace. There is no airplanes bombing me, attacking me. There is no need to dig a hole, you know." He said, "I want you to imagine that the airplanes are attacking you." I said, "Well, then I want you to imagine that I dug the hole." Oh, he got so angry. He left the garrison. He went, called everybody, called all the officers, and he proposed 14 years prison for me. I went to the warehouse. I kneeled down and I prayed for over 1 hour for my freedom. "Lord, please save me from prison. Lord, if I go to prison in a communist country, they will kill me there. They will torture me, beat me to death. I will never get home. Please free me." And I prayed and I prayed and I prayed and I got no answer to prayer and no peace. And I was struggling. And as I was praying, it came in my mind what my father used to say. Whoever wants to save his life will lose it. And whoever is willing to lose his life for me, it will save it. And my father will say, son, whatever you want to save, you will lose. But whatever you are willing to lose for me, you will save it. Now, I want to mention the Bible clearly says that we should seek God and his kingdom and his righteousness first. And the other things God promised, they will be given. So it came in my mind that Abraham lost everything. Moses lost everything. Joseph, he didn't want to go to prison, but he allowed God to put him in prison. If Joseph would have refused to serve God, he would not have gone to prison, but he would have ruined God's plan for him, because if Joseph didn't go to prison, Joseph would have never been prime minister of Egypt. I want you to imagine if Joshua, instead of following God's plan, would have made a plan how to take Jericho, he would have never got victory. Those people surrendered everything. And it came in my mind that I have to surrender my freedom and be willing to lose my freedom or my life. And so I changed my prayer. I said, Lord, I don't want to go to prison. But if you want me in prison, I will accept it. Peter went to prison. Paul went to prison. The spirit of prophecy in the book of Acts, in chapter 48 or 49, it says that God reached and saved more people when Paul was in prison than when he was free. God can turn a crisis into a victory. And I said, Lord, I don't want to go to prison. But may your will be done. I surrender my freedom. If free would serve you, let me be free. But if my prison would serve you, let me go to prison. Do to me, Lord, whatever would honor you and serve you. These people don't know you. Do to me whatever would show them that there is a God in heaven. You shall increase and I shall decrease. I surrender my freedom. I surrender my life. I am willing to give up my life and my freedom. May your will be done. Do to me whatever would serve you. When I prayed that prayer and surrendered my freedom, in that moment, somebody knocked on the door. Goya, open the door. I opened the door. It was a sergeant, a short guy. And he said, Goya, do you know General Joanna? I said, no, I don't know. Well, in Romania, there are four big armies. And General Joanna is the general of army number three of Romania. He's a man to be afraid of. He's a man with a lot of power. All the officers in Romania are afraid of him. General Joanna came to visit our garrison unannounced. It was a surprise visit. And he found us in the meeting that we had a meeting to put you in prison. And he said, I came 2 years ago and your roof was broken. Who fixed the roof? Now if the roof is fixed, there is no leak. And they said, well, Goya fixed the roof. How much did you pay him? Well, he did it as a volunteer. Wonderful. Last time I came, the fence was broken. Now it's fixed. And you didn't have money to fix it. Who fixed the fence? Goya fixed the fence. He worked with his father so many jobs. He knows how to do everything. How much did you pay him? Nothing. The driveway was broken. Who fixed the driveway? Goya fixed the driveway. The windows are broken. Who installed the glass and fixed the windows? Goya fixed the windows. He had a glass shop and he knows how to cut glass. Who did that? Goya did it. Wow, what a soldier. Did you reward him? Did you give him some money? No, we didn't. He's the best soldier you have. Okay, why are you in a meeting? we need to put a soldier in prison 14 years. Who do you want to put in prison? Goya. Why do you want to put him in prison? He doesn't work on Saturdays. Does he work the other days? Oh, yes. But he's dangerous for the country. Is he a traitor? No. Does he hate his country? No. Then why? Well, he's an Adventist. Leave him alone. If you touch him, you lose your jobs. I will punish you. I will put you in prison. If you touch him, you touch me. From today on, nobody should touch this soldier. I wish every soldier was like him. And then the sergeant looked at me and said, Goya, please tell me, are you friends with the general? I said, no. Do you know somebody? I said, yes. Somebody bigger than the general? I said, yes. I was referring to God. But they thought that I know the president of the country. From that day, for the rest of the military service, nobody touched me. I would walk through the garrison and all would salute me and say, Goya, we take good care of you. You don't have to work. You could go to church. You could go home. Do whatever you want. Just call the general and tell him that we take good care of you. I said, but I don't know him. Well, then call the president. Call whoever you know, because we know you know somebody really big. I had to surrender my freedom, and only then God saved my freedom. I had to put God above my freedom and my life. God cannot lead your life before you surrender your life. As long as you are in control, God is not. Cannot be both, either you or God. If you are in control, you make the plans. And that's the reason we don't succeed. Ellen White says that the reason for our lack of success is that we trust too much in our plans and wisdom and too little in God. Imagine if Moses made the plan to deliver Israel, he would have failed. One man. If Gideon made the plan for victory, he would have failed. If Joshua would have made the plan to take Jericho, he would have failed. If Noah would have made the plan to save the world, he would have failed. Why do we make so many plans instead of surrendering more? Instead of asking God's blessing for your plan, shouldn't we ask for God's plan in order to have his blessing? Again and again, if we are in control, God cannot control. If we are alive, God is dead. The reason God cannot give us power is because we don't surrender. It will be dangerous for God to give us power as long as we are in control. We would use that power according to our plans, according to our wisdom. And our plans are far from God's plans. We need to surrender. And then God is in control. Then he can give us power because he will control our will. And we will use the power according to his will, not according to ours. If God gave us power and we would use it according to our selfish nature, with our lack of wisdom, we would fail. We would use it in the wrong way. So let me give you an example from the Bible. Peter was a fisherman. And Peter was a good, experienced fisherman. Peter went fishing, as we know in the Bible. And in Mark chapter 1, Jesus walks by the Sea of Galilee. And in the morning, I don't know, it was 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, but the sun was up. In the morning, Peter is coming back with his friends, with all the boats, tired, not one fish. And Jesus says, throw the net in the right side. But now I want you to think about it. Jesus talked to him, and Peter answered back. That means that Jesus was close, because if Peter was on the lake, he would have never heard Jesus. Peter, ah, Peter, do you hear me? Ah, Peter was close. Hey, Peter, did you catch anything? No. He must have been 5, 6, 10 meters, really close, in order to have a conversation. Well, I've been there. When you go to that lake, on this side of the lake, not on the Gennesaret, not on the part where the demoniac people were, but on the Israel part of the lake. The water goes slow, and you walk, and you walk, and it goes like this, and then it goes to the knee, and you walk more in the water, and it goes to the hip, and you walk farther, and it goes here, and then here. And when you get 30 meters away, or I don't know how long, the water finally is here. Peter must have been really close to have a conversation with Jesus. That means that the water was shallow. The water was not deep. Well, if you know anything about fishing, small fish stay in small water. Big fish stay in big water. And Peter, if you know about fishing, you don't go to fish when the sun is up, 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock. You go to fish in the night, or at 3 a.m., or 4 a.m., or 5 a.m., not at 10 a.m. So Jesus says, throw the net. And Peter says, Lord, but it's morning. We tried in the night. In the morning, the fish doesn't bite. And the water is shallow. We tried at the deep, and we caught nothing, Lord. And Jesus says, throw the net. And Jesus threw the net. And you remember the story. It was so much fish that the net started to break. So Peter called the other fishermen, and they came with the other boats, and they threw the nets to help this net. And their nets were so full that they were breaking. And when they put the fish in the boats, the fish was so much that the boats started to sink. They have never seen so much fish in their lifetime. I want you to imagine if you caught so much fish that you would fill all the boats to the point that the boats would go down. I mean, if you sell that fish, you have money for 1, 2, 3 years. You really got it. You got a lot of money. You don't have to work for a few years. And then Jesus says, I want you to give up everything. I want you to give up the fish. But Jesus, look how much fish. If we sell it, I give 20% to the church, tithe. And then I give another 20% offerings. And then I give another 10% to missions. And then I give another 10% to the poor. And then 40% I put in the bank account for difficult times, economical crisis. And Jesus says, no, I want you to surrender all. I want you to give it all up and follow me. And Jesus says, very interesting, if you read there, Jesus says, give it all up and I'll make you fishers of men. But in Greek, he says, it's a conditional. In order to fish men, you need to give up your fish. Give this fish up and then I can make you fisher of men. You cannot have both. Question. Why would Jesus give him fish and then ask him to give up the fish? Why do you give me something and then take it back? Why did Jesus ask him to give up the fish that Jesus gave him to begin with? Jesus wanted to teach Peter two lessons that we all need to learn. Number one, unless you surrender everything, you will never be used by God. You may serve God. You may go to church. You may love God. But you will never have power and success until you are willing to surrender all. We do sing all to Jesus, but we really don't surrender all. And God doesn't take 90 or 95 or 98%. All or nothing. People who surrender 98%. Will die, will burn like people who surrender nothing. Because Jesus doesn't take a divided heart. Jesus wants it all. And before we learn to surrender all, he cannot control our life. He cannot work in you or through you. As long as we have a little of the heart that we keep for self, we fulfill Satan's plan. Jesus says, who is not with me is against me. You cannot be in the middle. You cannot keep it for yourself. Either you give it to God or you give it to Satan. He who is not with me is against me. Jesus wanted to teach Peter that he must surrender all. Otherwise, he can never be a disciple. You will never be a disciple before you are willing to fully surrender and die to self. God will never give anybody power unless they fully surrender. This is number one experience. Peter had to learn to surrender all. But number two, Jesus wanted to teach Peter a lesson. Who gave you the fish? Who gave you blessings? Who gave you health? Who gave you a job? Who gave you forgiveness? Who gives you eternal life? Who gave you the miracle of the fish? I gave you the fish today. I am able to give you the fish tomorrow. Trust in me. I take care of flowers. I will take care of you. I can send the birds to feed you. I can rain bread from heaven, water from the rock. Trust in me. Put me first, and the other things will be provided. If I gave you the fish today, I am able to give you the fish tomorrow. Learn to trust in me, not in you. People who surrender and trust in God are people that God can use with power. And so, that's the reason Peter could be used by God. Peter says later, Lord, we have given up everything. What do we get? And Jesus said to him, 100 times on this earth, plus eternal life. That's the reason Peter would preach. It was a simple sermon. Read it in the book of Acts. Really simple. Even a child can preach that sermon. Peter preached and 5,000 got baptized. And Peter preached again and 3,000 got baptized. That's the reason. Because when people surrender, the Holy Spirit works through them. But you need to fully surrender in order for the Holy Spirit to take over. That's the reason Peter's shade would go over sick people and the sick would be healed. That's the reason Peter went to Tabitha and prayed over a dead body and she came back to life. Paul surrendered everything. That's the reason God used Paul with so much power. I want you to imagine if today all our members would surrender all like Peter, like Abraham, like Moses, can you imagine the power that we would receive, the miracles, the growth that we would see in churches? If every church member would fully commit to God and to service, can you imagine what would happen? What a revival, what a power we would witness in churches. God is calling his church to surrender. Jesus is coming really soon. There is no more time for a divided heart. This is the time when we must surrender all and finish the work. I want to read a few quotations that are very, very powerful. I'm looking for the quotations. Give me 1 second. Okay, I found them. I'm going to share the screen with you. To everyone, that means everybody who offers himself to God for service. If you offer yourself for service, and now listen carefully, withholding nothing, that means full surrender. Withholding nothing for self. Total surrender, total commitment is given unlimited heavenly power for the attainment of measureless results. Unlimited heavenly power. If you fully surrender, you receive full power. All who consecrate everything will constantly receive physical and mental power. Wow. Listen carefully. The one who depends on his own wisdom and power is separating himself from God. Instead of working in unison with Christ, he is fulfilling the purpose of the enemy. The reason God's professed people have no greater power is that they trust too much in their wisdom and don't give the Lord an opportunity to reveal his power for them. Many who profess to be Christ followers are anxious, troubled, because they are afraid to trust God. They don't make a complete surrender because they shrink from the consequences of that surrender. Unless they fully surrender, they will never find peace. Listen, our Heavenly Father has thousands of ways to provide for us. Those who accept this one principle to make God's service supreme, one principle, full surrender, put God first on his service, make God's service supreme. Those who accept this principle, they will find perplexities vanish. What if everybody would surrender fully, would commit fully, no reservation, life or death? What if the whole church, Jesus is coming soon. This is the time to fully commit. The Holy Spirit makes appeal to us as leaders, as pastors, as church members to fully commit, to fully dedicate ourselves, to fully surrender and put God above anything, above life, above freedom, above anything, ready to live or to die for Christ. God is calling us to total surrender. I want to give you a story as we finish. A few years ago, we went to Cuba, and I had three groups. Myself with five people went 1 hour away from Havana. One of my elders, he was a bone doctor. He went 3 hours away from Havana. And another elder, who was an eye doctor, he and his group went 7 hours away from Havana. We went in three locations that had no Adventist presence. And we went there to plant three churches. And we prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed. And we got there and started evangelism Thursday night. As soon as I finished evangelism, my elder, that was an eye doctor, who was 7 hours away from Havana, he called me, "Pastor, I'm in trouble." I said, "Okay, what happened?" "The police came and they wanted to arrest us. And they locked the building, took our books. And they said, if you try to do evangelism again, we will arrest you in Cuba." "Pastor, I don't want to be arrested in Cuba. I want to go home." I said, "Man, what do you propose? I'm going to come to Havana and join your group. I will not continue here. I'm afraid." I said, "God sent you there to plant a church. Stay there. But what if they arrest me?" "Well, if Joseph didn't go to prison, he would have never been prime minister of Egypt. You may need to go to prison to be prime minister of Cuba. I don't know." "Pastor, please don't joke. I don't want to go to prison." "Hey, stay there. God put you there. Stay there. If Satan attacks you, it means you do something good. If Satan doesn't attack you, it means you do nothing. When Satan attacks you, that's not a reason to give up. That's a reason to pray more. You told me that you want to have an experience with God. You will never have an experience if you don't have a challenge. There is no need for a miracle if you don't have a crisis. The bigger the crisis and the bigger the prayer, then the bigger the miracle." "Pastor, but we prayed." I said, "How long did you pray?" "I don't know. That means that you didn't pray." "Oh, yes, we did." "How long?" "I don't know. That means that you didn't pray." "Well, Pastor, why do you say that?" "Because if you fast 5 minutes, you don't know. But if you fast 5 days, trust me, you know. If you pray 5 minutes, you don't know. But if you pray three nights, trust me, you know. If you don't know, it means you prayed very little." "Oh, Pastor, come on. How long do you want me to pray? 10 minutes, half an hour?" I said, until you get an answer. Well, what if I don't get an answer? Then you need to keep praying. How long, Pastor? I said, keep praying until you get an answer. Pray life and death. Pray like Jesus. Pray like Jacob. Pray like Moses. Pray like Daniel. Oh, Pastor, I've never prayed so much in my life. And then you say you are an Adventist? Jesus prayed whole night. Ellen White says, if Jesus prayed so much, how much more we need God's power and prayer? Pray without ceasing. He and his team started to pray at 9 p.m. that night. And they prayed until 2 a.m. He called me in the morning. We prayed until God impressed us what to do. And God impressed us to go back to the police. I said, praise the Lord. They went back to the police. And he talked to the officer and he says, what can I do to do evangelism? Don't you do evangelism. If you do it, we'll arrest you. Please help me, what can I do? No, you are not allowed to do it. Please. And the police officer turned the radio loud, music loud. And then he whispered at my elder's ear, soft so nobody could hear. Do you have a chocolate? Yes, I got two briefcases for the kids who come to evangelism. We don't have chocolate here in Cuba. Can you give me two chocolates for my children, please? Sure. Do you have a Bible? My wife and I would like a Bible, but don't tell anybody because I could lose my freedom. Come at 4 p.m. Let's meet in the park and cover them so nobody can see the chocolate and the Bible. Sure, I can do that. Well, I'm going to tell you what to do. You cannot do evangelism in a public building without proper papers. But you can do evangelism in a church and you don't need any paper, any approval. So go to churches around and ask them to allow you to do evangelism in a church. Well, my elder called me, Pastor, God answered. I got the answer. He went to the Baptist church, to the Pentecostal church, to the Apostolic church, to the Lutheran church, to the Catholic church, to every church. Nobody allowed them to do evangelism in their church. He called me, what should I do? Go back like the woman who went to the judge. Go back. He went second time to all churches. When he got to the Baptist church, the pastor says, well, if you came again, I'm going to let you do evangelism in my church on one condition. Our roof is broken. It's raining in the church. And we don't have money. Give us money to fix the roof and you can do evangelism in our church. And my elder said, how much money do you need? $2,500. So my elder talked to his wife, honey, how much money do we have left over? $2,500. Honey, what is that money for? For the whole team, for hotel and for food and for transportation. He called me, Pastor, the Baptist pastor wants $2,500 and then they allow us to do evangelism in his church. But we have $2,500, but that's our money to eat and to sleep. I said, give him the money. What do I eat? I said, you don't need to eat. I need to eat because I am asleep, but you are too big anyway, so give him the money. Pastor, please don't joke. The whole team, we need to eat, we need to sleep. I said, no, you sleep in the van and you fast. Give him the money. Pastor, do you want me to give up my food and my bed in order to do evangelism? I said, yes. But well, can you give me from your money? I said, no. If I give you from my oil, none of us would have enough oil. Pastor, can I pray that God gives me money? I said, don't pray for a blessing before you are willing to use what you have. God will never give you more as long as you have something. You need to empty your cup if you want God to fill it up. You need to be willing to surrender what you have if you want God to give you more. Before you are willing to sacrifice, you will never receive a blessing. He said, Pastor, but if I give the money and God doesn't bless, what is going to happen to me? I said, that's the problem. We don't surrender because we don't trust God. When he promises, seek first, and the other things will be provided. We don't surrender because we love self more than we love God. I want you to give up self. Give up the money. Give up your food and sleep. And pay for the roof of the Baptist church so we could do evangelism there. He talked to the whole team. They prayed. They decided to surrender their comfort. They gave up the money. They met that night in the Baptist church and continued evangelism. That night, the whole team, they slept in the van, very uncomfortable. And they didn't eat. The whole team went to sleep with no food, fasting. Next night, when they did evangelism, 156 people showed up. Who are these people? Because we used to have 15, 20, 16, but right now, over 150. And the Baptist pastor said, this is my church. I came to hear what you preach. I like it. So I called my whole church. My elder called me, Pastor, now I know that all things work together for good. God allowed us to lose the building and the money because God wanted the Baptist church to hear the message. I said, praise the Lord. That night, they're so hungry. He said to his wife, honey, you always have some money in your purse. You have everything in your purse. You know, in a woman's purse, you can find anything. If you turn it upside down, you can start a store. You find so much in a woman's purse. And he says, honey, maybe you have some money left over in your purse so we can buy a little food. I'm hungry. I didn't eat for 2 days. She looked in the purse and she says, honey, I found the envelope with the 2,500. You forgot to give it to the Baptist pastor for the roof. He called the Baptist pastor. Pastor, I'm sorry. I forgot to give you the money for the roof. The Baptist pastor said, you gave me the money. I have it in my hand. Then my elder called me, Pastor, you gave me by mistake another envelope of 2,500. I said, no, I didn't give it to you. Well, the angel of the Lord put an envelope of 2,500 in my wife's purse. We have money to eat. I said, praise the Lord. That night, they paid 300 for the whole team, for food and for hotel. They slept in the hotel, they ate in the restaurant, they all felt happy. Next day, they counted the money, 2,500. He said to his wife, honey, you didn't count the money properly. Maybe it was 2,800 because you paid 300 and we still have 2,500. She says, I counted the money. Let's count again. 2,500. That night, they paid again 300 for the whole team, food and hotel. And then they counted the money, 2,500. Next day, they paid 300 and they counted the money, 2,500. He called the whole team. They all got around and they all counted the money with witnesses, 2,500. They paid food and hotel and then they counted the money again, 2,500. This is real. This church member is alive, he's a doctor. You can call him or the whole team. He called me. He was happy. Pastor, you would not believe what happened. Pastor, I said, tell me what happened. We keep taking every night 300 from the money and the money doesn't go down. We still have 2,500. It's like the oil, the widow who gave the prophet, the oil and the flour, and the oil never ended. I said, wow, give me that envelope. No, you need to pray so God will do a miracle for you. They baptized 26 people. They planted a church there. Next Sunday, when they finished, they traveled back to Havana. When they started to use the money for themselves for the trip back, the money started to go down. The leftover money from all three teams we gave to the union to use for the local needs. That man was a changed man. He told me, I've been an Adventist all my life. And my parents and my grandparents, third generation Adventist. I go to church, I eat clean, I keep Sabbath, but I've never experienced God's power until I was willing to surrender all, to give up myself. When I was willing to put God above self, then I experienced God's power. I never knew that God still works today. That man could not keep it inside. He was not like a dead Adventist. Let's sing. Da, 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 da. He was alive. He was energetic. He had momentum. He would tell everybody in the church, you need to experience God's power. You need to surrender. That man was a transformed man. That man and his family planted a new church in that city. Right now, the church has 70 members. He cannot keep it still. Why don't we have power today? This is the most difficult subject. It's a lot easier to eat tofu or broccoli. It's a lot easier to know the state of the dead and the 2300 days and night prophecy. It's a lot easier to keep Sabbath because all you do, you don't work. It's a lot easier, but it's a lot more difficult to surrender all and put God above self, above everything you are, above your life. And God calls you and me. God calls us all to absolute commitment. And to the degree that we surrender, to that degree, God can work in us and through us. And Jesus is coming. And this is the time that God is calling the church to absolute surrender, no reservation. May God bless you richly. Precious people in your division. I love people there. I've been quite a few times visiting there. If there was no virus, I would just love to visit you again. But until then, we keep praying for you. May God bless you with results greater than we can even anticipate, with revival and power. But until then, God is calling us all to absolute commitment. God bless you.